I would like to start from a couple of interesting news from really this week. So investors who are starting to consider government's climate wrongdoing and the related risk in the sovereign bonds portfolios. And in particular, there was an announcement by Nordea and other Nordic asset managers to suspend the Brazilian government bond purchases due to mismanagement of Amazon fires. And in this regard, so we can think about three main research questions. So the first is, can we price a country's climate misalignment in the value of its sovereign bond, considering the characteristics of climate physical and transition risk, and in particular deep uncertainty and endogeneity? This means, what is the climate sovereign spread of a country? The second question is, what are the drivers of the largest losses for an investor's portfolio when we account for direct and indirect exposure, which means secondary or network effects? We know about in the last financial crisis showed the importance of interconnectedness and complexity in mispricing of risk. So this is what we need to account for and we can do now in a stress testing exercise. And the third is, how could this information support investors, for instance, pension funds who are not allowed to invest in very risky assets and have a large share of their portfolio, sovereign bonds, as well as central banks and regulators in informing their climate risk assessment and management strategies? We provide a contribution to the literature. In particular, we develop a framework for climate financial risk assessment under uncertainty to price climate transition risk in investor portfolio using a climate value at risk. This methodology is rooted on methods and metrics like value at risk, but also sovereign spread, and methods like financial network stress tests that are already known and used by and or used by central banks and financial actors. It embeds a model of transmission channels from a disordered transition. And what we mean here from a disordered transition is a late and unanticipated introduction of climate policy, and in particular carbon tax in this specific application by market participants that cannot price it in their in financial contracts and in investment decisions. We have forward-looking climate shocks that impacts on economic activities market share at the next four-digit level, and from here on firms' cash flows and profitability, and the shock is then transmitted to sovereign fiscal revenues, and from here to a revaluation of the sovereign bonds portfolio of the central bank. We apply to the 10 years sovereign bonds issued by OECD countries and purchased by OMB. And then we define some implications for central banks in terms of assessing the drivers of risk and price them at the individual and systemic level in order to identify measure, in particular prudential measures, to mitigate climate-related risk at the sovereign level. This is the framework. So we start from climate scenarios and emission targets. For instance, the last one published by the IPCC report 2014 and 2018. Then we use integrated assessment models to model the shock from a specific climate transition trajectory, which is forward-looking. So our approach looks at future and feasible climate transition shocks on the market share of economic activities at the next four-digit level. And in particular, these economic activities, we reclassify them in climate policy relevant sectors, and we'll see later what they are. And you can see here that given the characteristics of the transition shock, you might have a milder or a tighter shock on the market share of the individual activities. This is, for instance, electricity production out of coal in Europe. Then we develop a model to transfer the shock on the individual firm's cash flow and fiscal revenues. In particular, this approach allows us to consider the case of mixed companies, because in the reality, no energy or utility company now, or very few of them, are only brown or green, but they have mixed cash flows, and that's why we need to assess the risk at that and to price the risk at that level. Then we actually introduce climate uncertainty in financial pricing of sovereign bonds, building on a traditional Duffy and Singleton model, and we then run the climate stress test on the sovereign bonds portfolio. This allows us to assess to what extent finance could be a barrier in the achievement of a specific climate target that a country could have, for instance, in Europe EU 2030 targets, or a driver of its achievement, thanks to its alignment. We consider three specific characteristics of climate change and climate policy. The first is climate deep uncertainty. We know that the largest shocks are expected to occur in the midterm, but the localization is rather uncertain. We consider the non-linearity of impacts because the shock probability distributions can't be inferred from historical data. So historical data are not a good proxy for that. And also we know that they don't distribute in a normal way, but this actually has several implications on how you use standard financial pricing models. Actually, you cannot use a traditional Merton or Duffy model for this because of its assumption. And then we consider the endogeneity of policy decision and financial actors' expectations on the policy in influencing the investment decisions. We have an investor who is a risk-averse investor who aims to maximize assess the climate risk in her sovereign bonds portfolio, considering uncertainty of climate. The investor is subject to incomplete information because she doesn't know the distribution of the climate policy shock. Thus, she cannot compute a traditional value at risk and traditional beta or alpha calculation. The risk management strategy is based on the value at risk. The magnitude of the shocks on future asset prices, in particular, we consider your sovereign bonds, depend on several factors, which are traditional in sovereign bonds evaluation, like growth or risk premium, plus some climate transition factors, which is climate policy uncertainty and the result of the energy transition in the country. Then the investor considers a set of feasible scenarios that the portfolio should withstand and computes a climate value at risk conditional to these scenarios. When it comes to the sovereign default conditions, we have all the list of equations in the paper that I shared with you. We have just an outline here. We model climate policy shock transmission to the sovereign bonds value in a market that is not necessarily efficient. We know that we are not an efficient market. We have several examples of recent research on mispricing of climate risk. The bonds are defaultable, and, following Duffy and Singleton 1999. The payoff is dependent on the country's ability to repay the debt out of its fiscal revenue. And thus, the sovereign default conditions read as the value of the net fiscal assets at the maturity being smaller than its liabilities. And finally, the issuer defaults at the maturity if her assets are lower than the liability as the result of both an idiosyncratic shock, so the climate impact on the real economy, and on the and on the policy shock on the financial asset values. The climate policy shock is transmitted to the financial pricing of the contract via the change in the conditions of the economic activities. In particular, we consider N countries, J, composed of several sectors of economic activities, S. What are these S? S are the economic activities at the next 4-digit level that we mapped into climate policy relevant sectors, and in particular we developed a new refined the classification that we used in 2017. Why we cannot use NACE 4-digit activities as a per se? Because NACE are not don't include technology, and thus they cannot be used as a proxy of climate transition risk. I'm not talking here about a climate physical risk. Also, our classification, which includes fossil, electricity, energy-intensive, transportation, and buildings, allows to account not only for direct role of an activity in the emissions of scope 1, but also for the indirect contribution of an activity along the value to emissions along the value chain. And this is crucial because, for instance, fossil fuel companies in the emissions classification represent only 3% of total activities. But in that case, what's important is the transmission along the value chain. Finally, our sector can be mapped into the EU taxonomy, EU green taxonomy sectors. Well, I will not go on this, and I will go straight to the results for sake of time. This is the result of the shock on the securities revenue stream of ECB sovereign bonds. You can see we have example with two main integrated assessment models, WICH and GCAM. And what you can see is that actually we several countries like Australia, Norway and Poland, which we usually consider as very financially stable in comparison to other countries such as Italy, actually due to the composition of their economy and the direct and indirect role of fossil fuels and carbon intensive activity in their gross value added and GDP, for instance in Norway for the sovereign wealth fund, we have a shock on the bond value and thus a shock on what we call the spread, the climate spread of the country. And this is the overall shock on OMB portfolio. I cannot disclose the name of the countries because of supervisory reason. However, you might think that the shocks are limited. Well, you might think that the policy scenarios that are used in integrated assessment models so far, and those are still not being updated. And also, we also know that countries are not aligned yet, are not on a path needed to reach even less ambitious EU 2030 targets, so probably much tighter climate policies will need to be introduced. And third, we know that market expectations on even a few decimal points of change in GDP are very important in affecting the spread on the sovereign. Just look at Italy after the last elections. Thank you.